attorneys are for the appellant. Is it music, or as opposed to
music?
Music.
Yes, it's like a
song.
This case turns on the language in the deed that has been examined very closely in the Pressler case and in the Ford cases, which both sides have discussed at length. And the language says, restoration or repair is not economically feasible, one, or the bank security would be lessened. The insurance proceeds shall be applied to the security instrument. So that's what we're dealing with here. And we begin with a breach of contract claim, and we have a related claim, but that's what the heart of the matter. We have maintained that the bank didn't do anything to ascertain whether those two conditions were met. Let's hold aside the default for just a moment, because that presents us with a new, greater problem.
I'll just set that aside for just a moment.
Thank you. Okay. But let's talk about what happened prior to the default. And that is, this sentence has two conditional phrases, or half phrases, and then it has a non-conditional phrase. The two conditional phrases are conditions preceding to the bank's right to apply the security to the security instrument. And in order for them to move forward, they have to establish that the conditions preceding occurred. So that's why we've alleged they didn't do anything to determine whether their security was impaired or lessened. They didn't do anything on the ground. They didn't look at the plans. Obviously, if the house was burned, there wasn't much to see there. But there's a lot they could have done to determine whether or not it was feasible to rebuild and where their security would have been.
Counsel, Judge Gould, if I could interject. I realize you wanted to put the breach issue to the side. But really, unless I'm missing something, we don't get to the technical condition, don't have to get to the technical condition precedence and the deed of trust issue if your client was in material breach, which would normally excuse performance of the bank. So I think what I would suggest is if you could at least briefly address the significance of the breach or default for the case first, and then go on with the other stuff.
Certainly, Your Honor. So let's deal with the default. So lenders default regularly, unfortunately, and banks offer deferment programs, they offer forbearance programs, they offer modification programs. Bank of America offered that. We allege that in the complaint. And what Bank of America did while Mr. Music was trying to contact them and work through their program was they stonewalled him. And as a result, he ended up unable to pay his mortgage and went into default. But that's the bank's doing because the bank did not respond to his inquiries. Mr. Music did everything that a responsible homeowner should do. And in contrast to the cases that I just mentioned, Pressler and Ford, where those, not Pressler, Ford, he was in default. They were in default long before, I believe it was a fire there also. He was a worthless borrower. Our guy did everything he was supposed to do, and then when the fire happened, he called Bank of America and said, house is burned, I have insurance, let's work through this. And Bank of America stonewalled him. Then he ends up in default. And it's hard for me to see how Bank of America can say here, aha, we didn't do anything we should have done, namely communicate with you. You then went into default, and now we're going to take your,
But it's not the bank's fault that your client was relying upon the rental income to pay the mortgage. That's not, I mean, I know that's the situation, and that's why once the place was no longer habitable, you couldn't pay the mortgage, but that's not the bank's fault. That's just the way your client decided to structure the relationship.
Well, you're absolutely right, Your Honor. It's not the bank's fault that that was my client's, how he had things structured, but it was the bank's fault that it failed to communicate with him to arrange something short of foreclosure or foreclosure proceedings at default. So, people default a lot in this world, unfortunately. And when they do, they go to their lender and they say, what can we do about this? And Bank of America offered that program, as every lender does. There are a variety of programs. And
they don't promise to, it would be different, I suppose, if they had some kind of a contractual agreement whereby the bank promised that if for some reason, you know, your source of rental income dries up and you're not able to pay the mortgage, we promise we will work out something with you instead of foreclosing. There's no such promise. They might make general representations about their willingness to work with borrowers, but I don't think there's any breach on their part by not, you know, coming up with some solution. They have a contractual right to receive the mortgage payment when it's due, and your client can't
get it. Fair point, Your Honor. The bank does have an obligation to communicate with him with respect to his loan. And when they say, we will talk to you about forbearance or modification, whatever, which they did say, and that we allege that, then they have an obligation to do that. And we breached, breach of covenant of good faith. Again, that's good faith, is just having a conversation with the borrower whose house just burned down. And that's what the bank didn't do. So, that's...
Well, suppose they had in good faith discussed it, but not given him the release that he thought he needed to avoid a default, and he still defaulted with that change in it.
Well, again, I like the fact that we're going into what if. What if? So if the bank had said, we're not going to be able to give you a forbearance, he may have found an alternative source of funding. At this point, he was kept calling the bank, and you heard, and again, we said in the complaint that the bank had said, oh, we have the program, somebody will call you, submit the papers, do this. They led him down that path so that he didn't go pursue his alternatives. And again, the bank has an obligation here to treat its customer fairly, and Bank of America did not do that. So I want to go back to my first point, if I have a judge address Judge Gould's point.
Well, since we're going to go down that road on the what ifs, so what if Bank of America did not accommodate him and he tried to get another accommodation and that fell through too? Would we be right back to where we are now?
Well, then he's out of luck. Then the security is impaired because Bank of America did what he's supposed to and he wasn't able to. I'm out of my 7 minutes. Can I go ahead?
I think you can finish answering the question.
I'll answer that. And I just want to go. So the answer is everybody would have done what they're supposed to have done in that situation, and he's out of luck. But no, not everybody did. Not the bank didn't do what it was supposed to do in that situation, and the bank had an obligation to do so. I've used my 7.5 minutes.
You've got time for a bottle. We'll hear from the bank.
Good morning. May it please the court, Colin Daly on behalf of Appellees Bank of America N.A. and Back Home Loan Servicing. I wanted to state something at the outset that I think is important to recall, because we're going to spend a lot of time talking about the default, but it's important to remember that Judge Spiro below granted this motion to dismiss on at least two other elements in the claims, including lack of performance and lack of causation and damages. Those two elements were briefed in the briefs. They were in the order from the court, and they were not challenged on appeal, and this court could affirm on those two elements alone.
Okay, why don't we just stick with what we...
And let's go to the meat of it.
Yeah,
which is
so maybe you could just start by addressing your opponent's accusation, suggestion, whatever you want to call it, that you all promised to at least talk to the man. I mean, he was in a pretty desperate situation and reached out, and you all just stonewalled him. What's your response to that?
So before my opposing counsel became involved in the case, the prior firm that drafted the complaint, the original complaint and the amended complaint, inserted the allegations that are operative here, and they did not include any specific allegations as to, as Your Honors have noted, a specific contractual provision, a representation, anything anywhere saying we will forbear indefinitely while we need to work with you on this. Also,
well, I'm not even talking about a forbearance agreement. I'm just talking about, like,
having a conversation.
He's saying that y'all just didn't even talk to him.
So as the complaint alleges, that did happen. The complaint alleges a history of, I spoke with so-and-so on the phone. I went to this branch. They sent me to this branch. They requested this document, the fire report. They said they sent me this document. Now, there are some allegations that documents might have been lost in the mail or that at the end of the day, a forbearance was never reached. But the conversations happened. The documents were exchanged. My client received a fire report, total destruction of the property. My client told him, it's alleged in the complaint, we would investigate. Now, whether or not they investigated to their satisfaction, but if we're talking to answer your specific question, did the conversations occur? Yes, they did, as alleged in the complaint.
If that's what I can't help you with that, we'll transfer you over to this department. And that department says, I can't help you with that, we'll transfer you to that department. That's what, I think that's what he's alleging, at least, right?
Well,
does that matter ultimately? I think that was more what I was interested in hearing your response to.
I don't think it matters ultimately. And just real quick on the context of a runaround, I think it's easy to use these terms like runaround and they stonewalled me. But let's look at the allegations and what's going on. The fire happened. There's conversations. A check is issued. Or sorry, a default occurs. 2 months later, a check is issued. The bank says, we need to investigate. But here's a critical fact of this story. At the time of all of this, there was a lawsuit going on. Most of these communications, particularly about this check, which is alleged to be in dispute in the lawsuit, it became a subject of dispute in the litigation. These communications, a lot of them are happening by attorneys. So you have Mr. Music's prior counsel before prior counsel, and you have Bank of America's prior counsel before me, trying to figure out what to do with this check. There is an ongoing partition action, as the court knows and was briefed, in a partition action, Music alleges that his co-owner's estate, so complicated, had sued him claiming he did not own as much of the property as he claimed he did. A partition action in California court can result in a court-ordered sale of the property, which could wipe out the value of what the lender could receive back on its property. So there was a lot going on here that provides context to, yes, the conversations were happening, no, there was no stonewalling or runaround. There were people trying to get to the bottom of this. Unfortunately, we have a loan that is in permanent default status. The complaint alleges he could not make subsequent payments. That's it. That's where we're at. It's an unfortunate situation.
Yeah, and all it was.
Yeah.
All right. I mean, you've responded at least to my question. Are there other points that you wanted to make?
Well, I think it's critical that Judge Spiro did an excellent job in this case on the original complaint, giving them leave to amend. He did an excellent job on the amended complaint, really putting it to us to really prove our motion to dismiss up. And if you read the transcript from the oral argument, it was extensive questions about Pressler. I could get into every case if you want. I know this like the back of my hand. But it was... Judge Spiro gave them an opportunity. How could you allege, what facts could you allege to get around this? And they were not able to do so. And that is in the transcript, that is in the order, and it does boil down much to this permanent state of default. And the contract language, which, by the way, is not a two-condition section. It is a, if either of these conditions exist, the bank applies the loan proceeds or the insurance proceeds to the unpaid debt. But in the case law, just looking at this, every single case that has looked at this has decided this is the lender's right. If Judge Spiro had decided anything else, it would be an outlier. Well, and including Judge Sands' district in Georgia. It's a very fateful day for me that his average case was decided out of Georgia. And if you read the law in Georgia, I know we're not in Georgia, but they do an excellent description of the policy reasons why this has to happen. Why this is the case, not that it has to happen, but why it's the case.
Why is it, meaning once the borrower is in default, the security is deemed automatically impaired?
Yes.
Why is that exactly?
There are several very interesting policy reasons, and they're spread out across different cases. So I'll try to address them from Ford to the California Supreme Court to potentially Everidge. In Ford, the policy reason is that as soon as the loan is in default and it's non-performing, the beneficiary, which these days includes securitized trusts and pension funds, but the beneficiary is deprived of its contractual right to monthly payments, which are in Section 3. And it's deprived of its contractual right to foreclose on the property if it needs to. So,
but hang on, let's just assume I'm going to make up facts. Don't hold me to them for this. But let's say that the value of the house pre-disaster was $1 million, right?
Yep.
And the loan that the outstanding balance is, you know, much less than that, say $300,000. In its destroyed state, the property is in fact worth less than the loan balance. But everyone knows that, boy, if we get that insurance proceeds and rebuild this thing, the bank would be, you know, actually better off, right? So I don't see why, just because the person is in default, wouldn't you still need to do an investigation to say, okay, well, if we were to get this insurance, these
to church proceeds, could we in fact rebuild it to the point where the bank's security interest would be restored? And if so, why wouldn't the bank be required to apply the church proceeds to rebuild it? It just seems like then it's a win-win for both parties.
I think that's the most logical question to ask, and the answer is twofold. You ask, why wouldn't the bank need to investigate? The first question, the first answer we should look at is the contract tells the bank what happens here. The bank is not required to have an appraisal or investigate. It specifically carves out its right to determine if its security is impaired. Now, that is very favorably drafted to the bank. I understand. But that is the deed of trust language that we are interpreting here. So that's the first answer. So the contract just does not require it to. And the second answer is there's no real windfall to the bank here. If anything, there would be a windfall to the borrower, which I can talk about. But there's no windfall to the bank. Let's say the insurance is $2 million. The check is cut, the bank is only allowed to apply the proceeds up to the unpaid balance. It immediately writes a check to the borrower. And in this case, there's no allegation that the borrower never received the check. It held uncashed for several years.
So are you saying that the fear is, well, yeah, okay. Well, you started to say from a policy standpoint why this is such a good rule, and that's where I stumbled in my hypothetical. It just seemed like that's not a great policy, actually, to allow the bank to just stiff the borrower and say, no, actually, we're just going to apply the proceeds to the bank loan, and you're just out of luck. Sorry.
Yeah, and just to finish the policy section, the policy, I said, is spread out among several cases. So you have Ford, Ninth Circuit. But then you have this interesting discussion in Woody, which is a 1964 California case. And it references a case called Alexander, which is the California Supreme Court. And what it says is that the lender has an equitable lien on the proceeds, while the borrower has title to the property. The borrower does not have title to the proceeds of the insurance. The way these contracts are drafted is that it is for the benefit of the lender is to protect the security interest. And that is how Section 5 is drafted as well in numerous places, not just this particular sentence. And the Supreme Court had noted that the beneficiary on those proceeds. Now, these are just policy reasons. We don't even have to get into that because our argument is the contract is clear, the case law is clear, but it's interesting and it makes sense, and there's enough justification there in the Everidge case out of the Middle District of Georgia to understand the context of why this makes sense.
Okay. All right. Unless there are other questions.
Sincere thanks.
Okay, thanks very much for your argument. Sir, you have, I think, a couple of minutes left for rebuttal.
Yes, 30 seconds, Your Honor.
All right, Your Honor. So we go back to, in terms of addressing the bank's right to say, hey, you're in default. We tried to keep it out of default. That was the discussion we had before I sat down, and I think that's the part that the bank doesn't really want to focus on is their failure to act in good faith. Good faith is critical, and I think that was what Your Honor was really going to. What's the greater policy goal here? The policy goal is if people are playing nice in the sandbox, if they're acting good faith and doing everything they should do up to this point when there's this fire, make it work. Win-win for everybody, and that's what the bank was willing to do. I want to go back to where I started, which was the language that we're dealing with here Section 5 of the agreement. If restoration or repair is not economically feasible or lender security is lessened, those are conditions preceding, and a condition preceding has to be satisfied by the lender. They didn't do anything to communicate or to satisfy those conditions. They did nothing. They just let Mr. Music hang out there. They didn't do the inspection, and when he tried to keep the security from being impaired, they stonewalled him. And we didn't use the word stonewall, by the way. We were detailed in talking about what Mr. Music tried to do to obtain a forbearance or a modification, or if they were going to say, no, you can't do it, then go out and find a third party. There are lots of options because, Your Honors, projecting on what the numbers might have been here is probably spot on because it's San Francisco, and the value was no doubt there, particularly if the insurance proceeds were applied as they ordinarily would be, the bank security would be fully maintained and it would be able to recover any arrearage in the payments. So the bank was never at risk here, and the notion that they could ignore him and then deem their security to be at risk because he goes into default because they won't talk to him is not fair. And
should not be the law. Should not.
Should not.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you very much for your argument. The case just argued will be submitted.